In this video, we'll learn how pollution permits can help to correct the negative externalities of production. In our discussion on negative externalities, we learned that in the production process, some firms will emit harmful gases into the environment. These pollutants enter the air we breathe and can also result in acid rain. The impact of the firm's pollution is an external cost to third parties. To address this, the government can pursue a market-based intervention such as pollution permits. This is in contrast to command and control systems, which rely primarily on regulation as opposed to market-based systems. This will become clear later in the presentation. This policy has a few different names, but they essentially mean the same thing. Tradable pollution permits, or cap-and-trade schemes, are a market-based solution to address the externalities caused by polluting firms. They are an allowance designated by the government of how much pollution a firm is permitted to emit. There are a limited amount of permits issued to companies whom are free to exchange these permits with each other. Firms will be fined if they exceed the amount. I'll show you how they work and the diagram you are required to know. The government will issue a fixed set of pollution permits, quantity Q star. The supply is perfectly inelastic, as there is only a set amount of permits issued. The market demand for permits will be set at D. This results in a market price of P star. Now polluting firms have to decide whether it is more profitable to sell the permit or to clean up their act. If the price of cleaning up their production process exceeds P star, then it may be worth purchasing an additional permit in this market. For firms who can improve their production process for less than P star, there is an incentive to sell the permit at a profit. If demand rises further to D1, this makes it even more attractive to sell the permit to firms who can clean up their act for less than P1. Additionally, it makes it more expensive for polluting firms to procure another permit and may force them to consider investing in cleaner production methods. Overall, the permit system encourages firms to consider whether it is more cost-effective to improve their production process or purchase a new pollution permit. The government's intention may be to reduce the quantity of permits available in successive years. In this example, the government reduces the quantity of permits available from 2019 to 2020, thus reducing the supply of permits. This results in an even higher market price for permits against D1. With this rising permit price, firms must now carefully consider their best approach to resolving their pollution emissions. While such a system to address pollution may sound great in theory, there are still some key evaluative points to consider. First, prior to giving out permits, a government has to determine an acceptable level of pollution. You could argue that this acceptance doesn't necessarily tackle the issue head on. Also, will it appropriately address the full value of the externality? Secondly, firms that are in such a scheme domestically may face challenges when selling their products overseas. If their local government imposes these costs on them, they may lose their edge and cost advantages. Thirdly, the government faces administrative costs of operating a pollution permit scheme. It must be developed, operated, and firms must be overseen. If they violate the system, there will need to be oversight in place to ensure they are fined appropriately. Finally, the environmental issue is a global one, and firms need to commit internationally to reduce pollution if the goal is to be achieved. There is always the risk that polluting firms just relocate overseas to areas with less stringent pollution controls. By now, you should have a clear idea of how pollution permits can help to correct the negative externalities of production. If you have any specific questions or comments, leave them below and I will try to address them.